Retro.
Hey, this is Catherine Tabor, Senator Padmé Amidala from Star Wars The Clone Wars, and you're listening to Jay and Dennis on Podcast Stardust. Stay on the light side.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And we've got a great discussion with the voice of Padmé Amidala herself, Catherine Tabor, coming up on this episode. But before we get into our discussion with Kat, Jay, where can our listeners find us around the internet?
All right, Dennis, pretty easy to do. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
So we've got the release of Queen's Hope, the third book in the trilogy that E.K. Johnson wrote. And we were fortunate enough to, or you were fortunate enough to, Jay, to reach out to Kat. And since she's doing the audio narration of this book, and get her to come on the show and talk about Padmé Amidala. So this is pretty cool. We have a really fun conversation to share with everybody.
Oh, we sure do. And I'll tell you, it lined up just perfectly, actually, because we've been talking back and forth for months now, and it just hadn't really lined up. And finally, the Force was with us. And so here we are. So yeah, this is amazing.
All right. Well, let's not delay it any further. Here we go. This is our discussion with Catherine Tabor. Our guest is an accomplished actress with more than 100 acting credits to her name, but Star Wars fans remember her as Padmé Amidala from The Clone Wars, Numa in Star Wars Rebels, Vet from The Old Republic, Mission Vow from Knights of the Old Republic, Princess Leia in The Force Unleashed, and she is also the narrator for E.K. Johnson's Padmé Amidala trilogy, which includes Queen's Peril, Queen's Shadow, and the upcoming Queen's Hope. So welcome to Podcast Stardust, Catherine Tabor.
Wow, thank you. That makes me feel, that makes me sound so accomplished.
Well, you are indeed, m'lady.
Thank you. It doesn't feel that way, but it's nice to hear someone else say it. I'm like, wow, I should go celebrate.
Absolutely. Thank you so much for taking your time with us today. And we've been trying to get this together for a very long time now. So finally came to pass. The Force was with us. And yes. So here we are to speak with you today.
So yes, I'm so glad to be with you guys. I really am. You're both awesome, and I love seeing all your fun photos on Instagram and following you and stuff. So,
well, great. Well, we really appreciate that. All right. Well, let's get right down to it. So we did have some questions for you in our interview here today. And so, again, just thank you for taking the time for these. So we're going to start off with this one. So when creating a voice for Padmé, how much do you try to replicate someone like Natalie Portman, for example, who obviously was the actor in the movies, actress? And how much do you strive to make the character your own?
It's interesting because when we were first reading for Clone Wars, it wasn't so much a voice match, which a voice match is like a very specific industry term where you're supposed to be doubling that person's voice. And some of my compatriots are really talented at that. I mean, I'm sure you've heard James Arnold Taylor and other people just be able to do these crazy impressions. I don't really love voice matching. I come from an acting background, and it always felt a little bit like it constricted me to have to sound like someone. But in this instance, I just think I kind of lucked out because Natalie Portman and I just have similar resonance. And so I never really tried to sound like her. I did, though, you know, really watch and listen to her portrayals of the character of Padmé and what was already out there and tried to stay true to that. But I think, like I said, I just naturally sound like her, so it worked well. And also, I really respect her as an actress, so that's always easier when you're stepping into those shoes when you like the person and their work.
Mm-hmm. For sure. And you're right. You do have a lot of the same resonance and the same tone and that type of thing. And quite honestly, for me, when I think of Padmé's voice, I think of your representation most of the time because I feel like I've spent more hours with that character overall, you know, between the watching and the rewatching of Clone Wars, and then now having these books out here, this trilogy of books, and I've listened to all, well, two of them at this point, obviously, but the audiobook is my favorite way to listen to it. So I always hear your voice in my head, honestly.
Well, thank you. We do get that a lot now because we've done so many hours of the Clone Wars. And again, then for me to be able to do the audiobooks, it definitely, I feel, you know, very familiar with her, and I never have to be like, how do I put my Padme back on? She's just very much a part of who I am. And it's been over a decade now, which is just crazy to say.
Oh, man. Yeah.
It feels like yesterday.
Doesn't it always? It seems like the years pass by forever, you know, but Monday just lasts an eternity.
Exactly. Exactly.
One of the reasons we had wanted to have you on the show is that we do have E.K. Johnson's Queen's Hope coming out, and it'll actually have been released the day before this is going to come out on our feed for our fans. But you, of course, have done the audio narration for all of these books, and it is a time period that expands beyond what was in the Clone Wars, which leads me to this question. Have you found that there's a difference in voicing Padme for a book like Queen's Hope compared to what you've done in the realm of the Clone Wars?
Yeah, I mean, she stays, you know, consistent throughout the different genres and projects. But what you said is exactly the case. There are these different time periods. So she's at different points in her life. And then that brings out something different. If she's quite young, obviously she's going to sound different than later years. And she's, you know, very less experienced at this point versus having already been a queen and now she's a senator. So there's a difference in who she is as a woman, but still that same inherent character. And that's been one of the really just beautiful things about getting to work on EK's books, is getting to expand into these different areas and also getting to do a lot of sort of that inner monologue of her, where it's her thoughts versus watching her in the third person. So she's the same, but those little tweaks are just almost like different angles of the character, which has just been a real honor and so much fun to get to do.
Oh, that's awesome. And definitely because there's so many different facets of Padme's life that we see. I mean, we basically watch her grow up throughout the trilogy and the Clone Wars and then the books. You know, we get all these different facets, as you said. And, you know, also because you probably had to do a little bit more of a practice with the queen speak, so to speak. And yeah. So, you know, that kind of takes me into the next question. You know, how you talked a little bit about approaching those different facets of Padme's personality, but between the three books in the trilogy, Shadow, Peril, and Hope, did you have to do anything different, you know, besides the monologue or the queen speak or that type of thing? And, you know, what did you have to do to get ready to do each of those voices?
Yeah, the queen speak is so interesting because there isn't actually very much of it in the films. And so it was interesting to work on that. And then I mentioned before we started recording, Kevin Thompson, who's my director on those books. And it's just great to have someone like Kevin working with you because he knows Star Wars so well too. So that those would be the places where we could take a little more time, which you don't normally do in an audiobook. Normally in an audiobook, you pretty much read straight through, except if you have a technical error or mess up, and then you just kind of back right up and start again. But in these books, it's a little different because there could be spaces where we would take a little more time to make sure we're getting it right. That would be the queen speak, and then doing some of the other character voices, which, yeah, can be hilarious. but Kevin's done so many of the books that, you know, he can help me get to a place where we have a passable, I should say, at least we hope we have a passable Yoda, for instance, mm-hmm. even though it's not in my normal repertoire. And I think the one we joke the most about, though, is I have to do so much of the Emperor, and it's just mm-hmm. hilarious. I would always be joking and being like, they're totally going to give me the next Palpatine book. I'm just going to be the narrator because I'm so close to him. I just sound so like him, you know.
I love it though. I really do. And it doesn't take you out of the character though at all. I honestly, I truly believe that, you know, you do such a great job of changing the inflection. And you get that with an audiobook. I mean, you always have to remember that if it's one narrator, one person doing it, that the characters are going to change. They're going to ebb and flow just a little bit from what you're used to. But I mean, like I said, it never once took me out of the story. So, but I think that's such a cool process, that whole direction process that you get in an audiobook that might be, you know, different even than what you would get on the set of the Clone Wars. I just think that's super cool. So yeah, thanks for sharing that. And how cool is that, that you basically got to be front and center for all of these kind of backstories that E.K. Johnston created for Padme and all the handmaidens. That's my favorite part of the book, is just the relationships that they built up and, you know, just getting that glimpse of what it's like to be a handmaiden and all the different types of things that they're able to do and their specialties and their expertise and that type of thing. I just can't say enough about it. Dennis knows I gush about it all the time.
Well, and I felt a little bit like, you know, not even 1/10 of what he does, but it gave me that little glimpse into what Dee does with the clones to be able to do the different handmaidens.
Oh, yeah.
Because they're trained really to have the same voice as much as possible. But then to be able to go in there and have their slight different personalities and their different specialties come out, and to get to do it at different ages, was really fun. And, you know, on the first book, I had little printouts of, the, you know, pictures for each one and a couple little words underneath them that I was trying to highlight for, you know, each one and what I felt like would be their sort of slight different personality traits. But it was really cool when EK allowed us to sort of see their backgrounds, which really was fun.
Well, that's awesome. So did you have any creative control over being able to put that spin onto each one of those characters? Like you said, you know, you kind of thought about like what they would be like, and was that encouraged for you?
Yeah. I mean, and again, Kevin's such a great director and we had worked together before. And because I have done audiobooks, sometimes when, you know, people are stepping into some of these character voice books, they haven't done audiobooks before. And it really is its own animal. And then a Star Wars book on top of that is just a whole different ballgame even. And it's, I don't want to say that it's hard, because that seems like a weird word to use, but it's definitely not easy. And you have to be able to do all these different voices. And yet there's even a nuance to that, because if you go too dramatically different for the different voices, it really can pull people out of the narration of a story. So it's knowing the different characters and how do you suggest them as much as possible. And, you know, with Star Wars, I really feel a responsibility about getting it right. So if I know this character has this accent, I really want to try to get that right. Versus in a regular audiobook, if I'm the first person reading it, I can kind of have even more license. Mm-hmm. But in these, Kevin, I think, trusts me enough to let me come in, and EK as well, you know, to let me come in and just kind of do my thing. And I know these characters, and EK also fleshed them out herself. So I'm really going off of what she wrote in these books. But it is definitely an interesting and process, more than just like, you know, a quick saying a couple lines here. And and it, you know, some of my family members will always say that it's the most impressive stuff that I do, the audiobooks. And I'll be like, but I was just on TV. And they're like, no, it's the audiobooks.
Oh, that's great.
So, okay, well, along with that, and you mentioned all these different characters. When it comes to voicing characters like Obi-Wan and Anakin, do you get any tips from Matt Lanter or James Earl Taylor on how to do that? You know, since they've embodied those characters for so long, or do you consciously try to match what they did, or do you go back to the movies and maybe rely on Hayden Christensen or Ewan McGregor's performances for characters that we all know so well?
Well, I will say first, as a caveat, that I got to meet Hayden in person really briefly in Chicago at that last celebration that we had there, and he was just so sweet, and I am a huge, huge fan of his. But I think he does farming or something really cool too. Anyway, but Matt and James are my Anakin and my Obi-Wan. So when I hear their voices in my head, that's who I hear. And I have to say, I think at one point I asked James, I was like, just say this line, and then he sent it to me, and then I think it made me even more like nervous about getting it right. So after that, I just tried to emulate them the best way that I could. But it becomes different when it's like your friends, because you're like, well, what if this sounds like an impression and they're annoyed by the way I sound and, you know, it's insulting. So I have to say, honestly, and James and Matt are very good friends of mine, that they were trying to do their voices was more daunting than any of the other voices, just because in my head, I'm like, you don't sound like them at all. They're going to be totally insulted.
Now, I see you more as a big family, so I would imagine they would probably be more like your brothers and tease you about it than anything else, if that was the case. But
the thing is that they neither of them would ever say anything negative. That's what's funny. Oh, but I did feel like, I mean, I'm sort of that kind of person who I worry less about the opinion of strangers and more about the opinions of those that I really care about.
Sure.
And so that's why it was really funny. I was like, this should be the easiest one of all. I hear James talk all the time. But
did you find one or the other harder to do?
I think the thing with Matt is that if I'm going to do a male voice that sounds masculine, it is a little easier to put on an accent and then kind of live in that space. And because Matt is just a nice masculine sounding American accent, it makes it a little bit harder. But he has such a, you know, unique and specific way that he plays Anakin, that it's just trying to just get that vibe in there. And it's so clear in my like heart and soul what his Anakin vibe is, that it's just a matter of, can I somehow translate that out of my own body?
That totally makes sense. It really does. And as you were talking, when you said Hayden Christensen has some kind of a farm, I think he farms lavender, if I'm not mistaken. I thought I saw
that
somewhere.
I don't. It's
Quick
like
aside,
one of the most attractive things I've ever heard in my life. I was like, wait, what? He's a farmer and there's lavender? I am in.
Right? And it smells so good to go to that farm.
Yes.
But that's super cool. I'm always so interested in that creative process. I just think that is the most extraordinary thing that is behind the scenes. So speaking of behind the scenes, there's got to be some standout memories for you in the recording studio. So any of your Star Wars projects that you've worked on, you know, any of the video games, Clone Wars, the audiobooks, anything, do you have any funny anecdotes, stories, or just a memory that sticks out to you, anything like that that you could share?
I mean, one of the things that was just so cool working on Clone Wars was the just amazing guest stars that we would have, and just the amazing people on the cast. That as a new-ish, young-ish actress it was just crazy. It was, you know, I would be pinching myself, like, how could I be there? Just like Ian Abercrombie and just, you know, such amazing people. But I will never forget the time that Michael York was there for Blue Shadow Virus. And like, I'm just standing there like next to him and he's doing the yeah. And in my head, I'm literally just like, I'm standing next to Michael York. Like, that's so crazy. And he's just doing this cartoon with me right now. That's amazing. So there was so many great instances in the studio. But my favorite times really were when we as a Clone Wars family would get to travel different places together, when we did the USO thing that we did in San Diego and going to the ranch together and just spending time with James and Matt and Ashley and Dee in these scenarios where we were there for work, but then afterwards, you know, just Dee cooking pasta in the kitchen at Lucas Ranch, at Skywalker Ranch, and just taking walks with like Ashley and James and talking. And those are my favorite absolute times from this time period. And they were the personal and the coolest. And I wish I could share the magic of them with fans. I've shared some pictures, but some of these great moments, I guess, are just meant for us to have and to talk about in interviews.
Right.
I just think that's so extraordinary. You know, I'm always so impressed with those lasting relationships that are formed. And I feel like the animated series, Clone Wars and Rebels both, just the recording actors and the stars of the show are not just work buddies. You know, they really do form, you guys really do form this relationship. And I dig that. I just think that is so awesome.
Yeah, I can't, you know, like you always hear the people are friends and, you know, you're not sure. I do really think that there's something special about the Clone Wars and then the Rebels cast. And, you know, some of it, I would say, is that some of the people that were put together to be on those shows, like, you know, Vanessa in Rebels. I mean, she's also a great friend, and just her and James and Matt and Ashley D, just great people. And just generous, kind people that we really stayed friends. And they're still some of my, you know, just greatest friends that I could call if I was having a bad day or, you know, just needed someone to lean on. And it came from these shows. Star Wars is great.
That is.
Well, we've always said it's family, right? I mean, Carrie Fisher said it herself. Star Wars is family. And this just goes to prove it for sure.
Yeah.
This year, we've been doing a series on our podcast covering Attack of the Clones for its 20th anniversary. So we've been talking about Padme an awful lot. Do you have any favorite Padme moments or scenes or even an episode that was focused on her from the Clone Wars or even from the movies?
I mean, there's several things in the Clone Wars that I just really love where we just really, I think, get to see a little bit more of who she is. One of my just favorite early on memories was the arc. Oh my gosh, I just forgot what they're called. Malevolence, Destroy Malevolence arc.
Oh, yeah.
There's just some really cute, fun moments in there that it was sort of the comedic feeling of Star Wars. But I have to say too, you know, some of the dramatic stuff that we got to do and then coming back for just that sort of brief moment in the final season, it's hard not to have just felt the magic of that, and just while we were there and then even seeing it, just really, really loved that moment. I'm a sucker for anything Anakin and Padme, I have to say. So those are definitely, even from the movies, those are my favorite scenes. I love the aggressive negotiation scenes. I love the floating apple or whatever. It's not an apple, probably, whatever Star Wars fruit it was. I like those romantic moments. So, and I know I'm not alone in that.
Definitely not.
Oh, for sure.
How big of a surprise was it that you all came back for that final season and you got to do that one, like, because Padme showed up for as a hologram with that conversation with Anakin, that you all got to do that one last time?
It was a surprise, but in a weird way, I mean, I'm an optimist, and I believe that good triumphs in the end. And so I felt like Clone Wars needed to have a better ending to its reign or run, I should say. And so it was like a surprise and yet also a, yeah, this is right. This feels right. So
that's perfect.
It was both.
Yeah, yes. It worked out so well because it blended in with the way that Revenge of the Sith kicks off so very well that it was really welcome return.
Well, everything
and I'm still
about
hoping
it.
On that note that Star Wars Detours is going to get to that people are going to get to see that someday too, because in a completely different way it's so great and needs to be seen.
Oh my goodness, that would be amazing. Absolutely amazing. I'll tell you what, I know, you know, when the Clone Wars was originally canceled, it was such a shock. At least, you know, to me, when it was canceled, I know, because when I was raising my boys, they were so little at the time, and they basically were being raised on Star Wars. And of course, I loved it too. So it was a way for us to spend time together. So Dennis knows this, our listeners know this, I've told the story before, but I wept. Like, I went through the entire grief process when that was canceled. And it was really, really hard to come to terms with, because I did feel like, you know, as you said, there wasn't any closure there. And so this really brought it back full circle in that final season and did put not only the closure on what, as you said, needed that quote unquote better ending, but it also opened the doors to so much other, you know, thread tying together in that tapestry of what is Star Wars as we know it. And I appreciate that season so much for it. So I'm so glad that y'all did that.
Yeah, we were too. And it was just fun to even just be back in the studio, whether we were working or not. It was just nice to be like, oh my gosh, we're here and we're together. So it was beautiful. And I got the call that Clone Wars was canceled and Detours was canceled within, I don't know, like an hour. And I know Dee was on both shows too. There were a couple of us on both shows. It was like, that's not a great day.
No.
Gosh, talk about a punch in the gut. Yeah, that'd be oof. But
like I said, as the eternal optimist or whatever I am, I still feel like it's going to happen. It is. So
put that energy out there in the universe, and guess what? It paid yes. off. Yes. That is awesome.
We could all use a good Star Wars laugh right now, so that's why I think they should really put it out.
Heck yeah. We can always use those laughs, that's for sure. So we have one more question, unless of course it leads us to other ones here, but kind of already answered this question in some ways, but you know, there's some creative differences, I'm sure, between doing, for example, a video game. So Knights of the Old Republic, for example, versus the animated series versus the audiobook. So can you just once again, or, you know, reiterate what those, some of those differences are, or if we haven't touched upon some of those yet, you know, can you bring those to light for us? That'd be great.
Well, when you get to do an animated series, as we did Clone Wars, and you're working for the most part in ensemble, that just is really beautiful when you like the people you're working with and they're talented. So that energy of being in the room with them, and then, you know, people like, you know, Matt and I and Ashley and others too, but especially if you came from an on-camera acting sort of background, definitely you would still be looking at the other person across the room, and you know, and having James beside you and the two of them working off of each other just creates a special kind of energy and magic. The video game, you're isolated by yourself, usually, occasionally you're not. And you're sometimes even isolated with the material, because sometimes they're not releasing what's happening around you and you just have lines. So it becomes, you know, a different process of trying to bring it to life. And, you know, I'm one of those actors who's always like, I kind of need a little bit of information, and occasionally that will even annoy a director, because I think they'll be like, oh, well, it's just say your lines. And I'm like, yeah, I kind of want to know why I'm saying what I'm saying here. And I will say most directors actually respect that. But, you know, if you're in a time crunch on a game and you have a quick deadline and they're just like, just say the line, I'm the actress who wants a little bit more information as to why I'm saying it. And sometimes you just don't get much of that with the games. And then audiobook, you've got this whole story. You're responsible for all of it. And all these different characters. And usually, like I said, in a just a general regular audiobook where you're creating all of that yourself, it's a great creative process. It's so much fun. And then when you put the Star Wars on top of that, there's a responsibility to create the whole story and yet be true to these things that already exist, have existed in some cases for many, many years, and that people have real strong opinions about. So you definitely put in more work on these Star Wars audiobooks. But again, in what other arena would I have had the opportunity to play, you know, Yoda and Palpatine and Jar Jar Binks and all these characters, even if for a brief moment? So
Absolutely. Well, I have one more question, if that's okay.
Sure.
How do you take care of your voice? So what do you do to just make sure that the pipes are healthy, you know, kind of a thing? Do you have any kind of a regimen, or just kind of do your thing because it's just, you know, it's you? Or what do you do? Anything?
I mainly just try to stay healthy in general. And if I'm, like, for instance, tomorrow I have two jobs, so like back to back, and they'll be kind of long. So I won't talk a lot tonight. I won't like get on the phone and have long conversations with anyone. And there are some things that you can do if you're having problems, you know, like in studio, a lot of people have tea and different throat coat things. I actually like just water with honey that's warm. Mm-hmm. And for some reason, I just like the plain. But it really, for me, has more to do with just keeping, you know, myself as healthy as possible. And if I know that I'm working and I've got auditions or things that are going to be stressful, taking it extra easy. And I know there's opera singers and people who do all these amazing exercises and things. And I used to, when I first started, I used to try to remember to do stuff, and then I just would always forget. So you're like, oh, I should have done that first. But it's just being smart, you know. It's being smart about it and taking it easy. And, you know, I will say, on kind of a, you know, I don't know if it's funny or whatever, but I definitely make a concerted not just effort, but I would never go out and, you know, have a really good time, like drink a bunch or whatever, the day before a session, because that would be miserable. And in fact, now as I've grown older, I'll try not to book anything, for instance, early in the morning, the day after St. Patrick's Day, being an Irish girl. I'm like,
smart.
Well, I'm going to be up late and there are going to be some Irish beverages involved here somewhere. So I cannot work until afternoon on the day after St. Patrick's Day.
Perfect. Oh my gosh, that's so perfect. Oh, I love it.
All right, then. Well, that brings us to the end of the discussion. Kat, thank you so much for doing this. Queen's Hope, it was out now, and our listeners can find your audio narration, I know, on Audible and other platforms. But what else you got coming up that you can talk about that people should be looking for?
I'm always like, what can I talk about? There are a couple things I can't talk about, actually, that I think will be fun and exciting. So the things I can talk about are... gosh, there's several things I can't talk about.
All right, take your time.
So we'll just stick with check out Queen's Hope, which is out now, according to the date of this airing of this podcast. And it's got some Anakin and Padme in there. So I know that will make people very happy. And then you can still hear me on The Loud House on Nickelodeon. And yeah, it's very funny. Like sometimes, you know, you do interviews where you're like, oh, there's just stuff I can't talk about, but there's not really that much exciting. There's several things I just can't talk about. So maybe next time.
Completely understandable. And we're glad that you're saying maybe next time, because we would definitely love to have you back again. That's for sure.
Oh, yes, thank you again.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys. May the force be with you.
And you as well.
All right. And that was the woman herself, Catherine Tabor. She was incredibly generous with her time. She has a busy evening ahead of her and a busy day tomorrow from when we're recording this. And for her to carve out 40 minutes to talk to this was beyond generous. And I can't thank her enough for that.
Oh, absolutely. And it just goes to show, you know, once again, that all of these voice actors that we've been so blessed to talk to are just so incredibly generous and gracious. And Kat is just so for real. And I just love that she's one of us too. You know, it comes right down to it. She's a fan and she really cares about the character of Padme and everything that she does, obviously. And she puts her heart and soul into it. And it just really shows in the quality of everything that she does.
Indeed. Indeed. All right, then. Well, then, I'd like to thank you all for listening to another episode of Podcast Stardust and our discussion with Catherine Tabor. We hope you've enjoyed this episode. And if you did, please make sure to subscribe to Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher of choice. We were missing for a few platforms for several weeks, but that's all been resolved, and you should be able to find us wherever it is that you listen to your podcasts. And also, you can find all episodes of the show over on RetroZap.com, which is also the home to several other great podcasts covering everything from the MCU and DC to Dune and Star Trek. As always, we greatly appreciate 5-star ratings and reviews on your podcatcher, especially if that is Apple Podcasts. And don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes on social media with your friends. Speaking of which, Jay, what are those social media contacts? One more time.
All right. We'd be happy to share those, Dennis. Yes, we were, for whatever reason, the Phantom Menace got us on some of those those platforms. But again, we are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And you can always check out our Pinterest boards and our YouTube channel, which does have all of our episodes, as well as some unboxing videos of some really great products. And if you want to catch us up for some real-time chatter, you can head on over to our Discord room on the RetroZap Discord server, where we are just one of many, many shows. All the RetroZap shows have their own room over there, and there's some great dedicated rooms to a lot of other types of things, from books, comics, general geekery. So you just got to come out and check it out. So just go to our show page, click on our community tab, and it'll take you right to where you need to go. And if you need some new updated swag for your wardrobe, why not head over to TeePublic? They were just having a great 40% off sale just this last weekend, actually. And so they do a lot of those sales periodically. So I try to put those up on our Instagram. But if you need anything from t-shirts, sweatshirts, coffee mugs, stickers, phone cases, laptop cases, you name it, it's probably over there. It's teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. So with that, Dennis, I know you've got some other things going on, namely with Warp Trails and your other podcast. So why don't you tell everybody about that?
Sure. So Warp Trails is the Star Trek podcast that my wife, Beth, and I are covering all of the latest episodes of Star Trek coming out on Paramount Plus. So that is Picard, Discovery, Strange New Worlds, Lower Decks. We are covering it over there, and it is a RetroZap podcast feed exclusive, so you can find that on your podcatcher of choice and hear what we have to say about Star Trek. We're having a good time with that. Jay, what's going on with cosplay?
All right. Well, over on my Instagram, which is at j.snipscosplay, you can catch me all the time, mainly as Ahsoka. And I do have a couple of new edits that just came out from a user called Big Criffing Deal. And he was kind enough to do a couple of neon edits for me, which were a lot of fun. And I'm still very hard at work at my Hera cosplay, which I'm hoping to debut at the end of April here. So be on the lookout for that. But as usual, just having a lot of fun interacting with other cosplayers, content creators, small businesses, other fans. And it's just, it's a really great, fun community. Really, really suggest that you come out and check it out. And then again, that's at j.snipscosplay.
All right, then. That'll do it for episode 396 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.